I will show you.
Steve.
The file. This is from Landsat data. This is, let me. So I think if you want to analyze land use land cover, then you will work with this type of files, Landsat data, and currently there is Sentinel-2 with 10 meter resolution. This one,
okay.
If we process, we can merge between one band with another band and make the resolution increase 2 times from 30 meters to 15 meters. Basically, for regional assessment, I think it is like de facto files that used by researchers.
Okay. So this this picture showing is a picture or is it like mountainous? Looks like mountainous, right?
This is city, Semarang city.
Oh, city. Okay.
City. So this maybe I will start from vector first. I will touch the raster part later. So basically, the Earth is the real world. It is three dimension, and GIS is modeling. So we have to model the object on the Earth surface with three types of shape: polygon, lines, and point. The way we describe or we visualize the object with a point or polygon, it will depends on the scale. So for the city, like if we use low scale map, like maybe 1 million or 150,000, maybe the city will be shown as point. But if we use 150,000 or 125,000, then the city will be described by polygon. So this is the basic of GIS. We want to show the object by using symbols, either polygon, lines, or point. For lines, usually we use for road networks, we use lines. And the most, not one of the most important thing that we should grasp is the concept of coordinate system. Here in QGIS, there is one symbol, this one, current CRS, coordinate reference system, is UTM, Universal Transverse Mercator. The basic coordinate system is geodetic. Show you this one. This one, geographic coordinate system. Basically, it's a three-dimension coordinate system. You already know that the latitude starts from the equator, zero, And then to the northern part, it will be northern region, and then lower part is southern region. And for the longitude, it's imaginary lines from northern pole to Greenwich and to south pole. But mapping means we have to use two dimension coordinate system. Theoretically, we can use this geographic coordinate system for our data, but since it's a spherical coordinate system, there will be errors, like because when we can read further in this website, I think. History. Coordinate system. Because the Earth is three-dimensional, then and when we have to make it two-dimensional, then it will lose this. There will be distortions in terms of shape, distance, direction, or area. So when we want to navigate from one part to another part by sea, then we will consider the most important thing is direction. We will not care about the distance as long as we can reach the destination. But if we deal with if we work for a tax agency, then we will not care about the shape as long as the area is precise. So there are many type of projection and coordinate system. So we have to find, or we have to understand this concept. Otherwise, when we want to overlay the data between different coordinate system or different projection, it will not overlap. But current GIS software usually transform the data on the fly. So when it reads the metadata in the file, like if it has this PRJ file projection, then it can automatically transform the layer. So I will show you two files, same files with different projection. So I have road networks. Maybe I will just change this to blue color. So before the lower file, it has UTM projection. This is European Petroleum Survey Group. They divided the Earth to many zones like this one. So this is the code. 327 means it's in the southern part of the Earth. If it's northern part, it will be 326. This is the raw data with UTM projection. And this one with geographic coordinate system. So current GIS software will automatically transform the file. So it will be shown overlap. Otherwise, it will not overlap. So this is projection system. Maybe you can learn more from the reference coordinate system and projection, map projection. And another thing for vector files, I think polygon area and lines and projection scale. Yeah, scale, I think it's easy. Lower scales mean 1 per 1 million, something like that. So the higher the scale, then the information will be more detailed. Okay, then related to directly with your research, for example, if we have, is there any reservoir? Let me see. Okay. For example, we have this reservoir, water reservoir. Oh, okay. Maybe something I forget. The difference between GIS and what do you call AutoCAD is the database. So when you double click when you right click the file and then open attribute file, then you will notice this table. So this is the difference between CAD file with GIS file. For CAD file, there is no database, but for GIS, there is database. And this database is processor file is safe in this DBF file. So if we open this one with Excel file, we can see the table. But it is better not to use the Excel file to open the DBF. So we should modify the data with GIS software, with QGIS or ArcMap. We can change. Okay. I will not change this one. Okay. We have road network. And then we have this point. So usually for accessibility analysis, there are two ways to measure the accessibility. First is we use Euclidean distance. So it's like direct distance from one point, and then with circular distance, so in radius. So if we define, for example, this point, and we want to see what type of land use within 500 meters, then we use the buffer method, for example. Let me check. This is in, I hope, oh, this is in geographic coordinate system. So another concept that we have to consider is when we use geoprocessing or we analyze data, we have to know the projection. So for example, if we want to use buffering, then the distance will be in degree. If our data is this coordinate system, this in this projection. For example, I will put this degree. Then this is the result of the buffer. This is one simple way to define the access area. For example, if we define 500 meters, then we will make the radius 500 meters. If our data is in latitude longitude, then we have to convert this data to UTM. So in GIS, in QGIS, it's easy. Just right click and then save features as, then save it. For example, this is reservoir UTM. Then we change this coordinate reference system to this one. So for Bangladesh, it will be different zone. Usually I use this UTM DMAP. Then we can see different zones. Maybe for Bangladesh between 45 and 46. In between 45 and 46. And if you have data from 45 or 46, to combine those data, you have to define one data to another. So for example, you have 45 and 46. You have to convert the data from 46 to have the projection into 45. So you have to transform 46 to 45. So it will be, so the data can be combined, can be overlapped with one another. So this is, we have these two files in latitude, geographic coordinate system and in UTM. So if we use UTM, then when we process buffer, we can measure, for example, 500 meters. Let's go. 500 meters, then so this is the file. But this is the simple way to analyze the area surrounding one, for example, one wells, one well or another type of reservoir. Then another way is we convert this vector file to raster. So we have, I will just convert this so we will make that okay, like distance to water. This is, I will show you the where is it? Should we? This one. So this is distance to water. So this is we will make this kind of distance. So basically, if I put main river, then maybe so the this usually we use this analysis. This is called Euclidean distance. So the raster overlap with the river will have digital number 0, and when it goes further, and the number will increase, but it will, for example, like this one, it goes increase, then it will stop because it will reach with the other distance from the other segment. So this is Euclidean distance. So maybe better to make from the main river. Okay. So it has this attribute. Usually when we want to make the vector file to raster, then we have to make one attribute, one column with the same, for example, I will make it RID, raster ID. Then the type of data that can be save in one column can be number, whole number, decimal or float, text, date and time. So we will use whole number, and output field length, we have to make it efficient. So if we will put the number only between 0 until 99, for example, then we have to put the output field length to 2, but the default is 10. But if we put 10, then there will be some slots that will not be used, so it will not be efficient. So we will put this one 1 because we want to make it as a raster with the same digital number. So we have this RID. The data is main river. Then we convert from vector to raster. It's called rasterize. Then we put the input layer main river, and then field to use is RID. And output raster size units is let me check pixel. Make it 30 meters. The extent will be used, for example, I will use main river. So let's see. We're not correctly generated. Maybe something wrong with my library.
So okay, that's why I'm gone.
This is basically it will create symbol not fine. Yeah, this is, let me check. It will create a raster file. Then after that, we use this proximity or raster distance. We use the raster file, for example, the main river, but in raster format. I didn't check this error, maybe because of the library, something wrong with the library.
It's okay, no problem.
Okay, so, but we will have this distance to water. So basically it's a raster file. And another method is we use the method surface area. So surface area means we will use road network. So we have this road network in UTM, and then vector layers with start point. For example, I have this production reservoir. Then I have path type to calculate shortest or fastest. Shortest will use distance as the, what do you call, the impedance. So fastest use time. Usually we can use like 5 minutes walking distance as 400 meters, or 10 minutes walking distance is 800 meters. So usually I use that number. So for example, I will put 800 meters. Then I will create the surface area lines. Surface click run. Ah, I forgot one thing. There is one
something value missing, right?
Topology tolerance. This one. So I will turn off this. We have this. Coin production reservoir. So when we want to calculate the surface area, we have to put the topology tolerance. So we can use this measure line. We can calculate from this one to this one. So it's around 30 meters, 28 meters. Otherwise, if we don't put the tolerance, then it will not produce the correct result. So let's see, make it, for example, 50 meters. Then when we put 50 meters, then the software will snap the point to this road network. So where is, okay. So we have this result. Okay. You can see this is the road network, and this is the road network within the walking distance of 800 meters from the this one to reservoir. So basically, this is the theory of accessibility. So we use the roads, then how many minutes that people can tolerate for finding water. Or how many kilometers? For example, maybe for rural area, 2 kilometers, 5 kilometers is okay, right?
Yeah, that's normal.
So it depends on the assumption. This is the method. So we have this line. Then the next step is to make this line into polygon. So we will make buffer reservoir lines, and then for example we put before we put 800, no, maybe let's see 100, and then dissolve the result. Still processing, okay. Okay, it finished. So this is the area accessible. So people within this area can access this to a reservoir. It's symbol. This, so it's accessible within 800 meters walking distance. Then usually how many population within this area? So usually we use Wolpop. Have you heard Wolpop? It's Wolpop. Wolpop, or you can have high resolution Facebook population dataset. I don't know whether Bangladesh already covered by this Facebook, but for Wolpop, for the whole world, it is data.
Oh, Wolpop.
And there is like not only the population density, but also demographic, like maternal, newborn health. So in detail. Maybe.
So where can I get these Bangladesh things?
You can go to this
site. Okay.
Yeah, this worldpop.org. There is data, population, birth, pregnancies, and others.
Okay.
You can go to individual countries, then search Bangladesh. For Facebook high resolution dataset, I don't know whether Bangladesh is covered or not, but you can check this one. The resolution is 30 meters. For Wolpop, the resolution is 100 meters. So one pixel is 1 hectare. So we usually we put this.
Okay.
Then we will calculate the population covered by this area. So there is one, I always forget this area, zonal statistic. Zonal statistic. So the raster layer is the Wolpop. And then the vector layers containing zones is buffer. Then the statistic we will use maybe count, sum, mean. Maybe this is enough. Then we click run. The result will be written in. Where is that raster layer? Is IDN? Ah, sorry, I forgot. So you can see this zonal statistic. To use zonal statistic, we have to use. We have to put the raster layers with UTM and vector layer in UTM. So it should be the same coordinate system, same projection. So that's why when I calculated this one, the result didn't come out. So I will just retry the process, but I will first I will crop this raster. If I zoom to this layer, it will be the whole Indonesia. And when I convert the projection, it will take some time. So I will make the raster file smaller by using the extent of the buffer. Actually, there are many many area, many reservoir area. Then I will create an extent based on these four areas. Usually, I use this research tool and then extract layer extent by using the file. So we will have this. Basically, it will use the outer part of the polygon and then make this rectangle extent. This extent will be in UTM. So to clip the raster file with the geographic coordinate system, we have to save this extent to 4326. Yeah? Then I will this pop. Pop Semarang. Okay. So we will clip this raster with pop Semarang using raster extraction, clip raster by mask layer, and then this is pop Semarang. Source layer is this one. Let's check, is it possible to make directly to UTM? Let's check. I think I think I have problem with this library in Mac. So I cannot crop. So let me
you can construct again.
Okay, maybe I will just convert this buffer to ratlong. Then we can check. This is water ratlong. Okay, then we'll try again the zonal statistic. The raster layer is a population. This one, okay. Okay, so now we can see this result. So there are 4475 pixels within the area, and then the number of population covered by the area is 25,000, and the population density is 54 point something. So this is one analysis for accessibility, one type of method for accessibility analysis. But usually the most use methods. The first is that Euclidean distance. So you don't need, if you don't have the road network, then you can use Euclidean distance to make that distance to water. Where is it? But if you have road network, then better to use the surface area analysis. Water. This one. This is Euclidean distance. Okay. I don't know. Factor file. And working with GIS also, we have to learn how to input our data. For example, if we have Excel sheets, then how to put our data to GIS. Maybe we can try.
What kinds of data we can import from Excel file?
From Excel file, yeah.
Yeah.
For example, you have survey sites. You put ID, for example, and then you have like the name of the surveyor.
Okay.
And then you have date, and then other things. You can put as many column as you want, but there is limitation. I think maybe maximum is 255 columns.
Okay.
But most of the time you should have this number, for example. Then you have name, for example. This one, and then date you can put. Yes, make it easier. Then you have latitude and longitude. Then I will just from this I will. Okay, let's see. 110 minus 967. This is 110.28. For example, 110. 40 is okay. What's this number? I'm not used to Excel. Maybe I will just put text. Maybe Yeah, okay. 104, 105, then minus six. This is for example. Then we can save it. Usually we use CSV file.
Okay.
This one can use point. Basically, this is the common text file that we use. Then in QGIS, we can use layer, add layer, and then add delimited text layer. Then we go to the folder. We have this point. Then usually we can see the preview. So if it's correct like this one, then it is the format. We can try use comma. It's not the format, so we use semicolon. Then the X field will be longitude, Y field will be latitude. Then don't forget to put the coordinate reference system. It is it depends on this data. If in geographic format, then we have to put this EPSG 4326. But if it's in meters, then we have to use this one. Then add. So we have this point. Where is this? It's not shown. Ah, where is this? let's see. It is maybe I did. Let's check. Okay. It's not this. I made a mistake. Latitude is should be this minus, right? The longitude, latitude. Y field, okay. So I made a mistake when I input the data.
Okay, no problem.
Latitude should be minus. So X field should be this one. Right? But Y field should be this one. Wrong. So it's a mistake. Then if we go to this one, okay. So it's outside Semarang, but it's okay because this one. Basically, that is the way to import the data, but it's still in table. So we have to export it as save file. So this is a survey, for example. That is one way of putting our data to GIS. We can use Excel sheets, but if you want to do survey, then you want to collect data with specific questions or specific information that you want to collect with photo or maybe a coordinate, then usually we can use I prefer to use this Ultra Consulting, this application. We can use QGIS and also mobile apps to collect the data from the field.
Like, a huge data.
Pardon?
A huge data, right?
No, actually, you can use apps, for example, and you put your design in QGIS and then go to the field and then collect data, for example, date, notes, photo,
okay,
synchronize to the cloud, and then you can show the result using QGIS. But I will not explain this method now, I think, because it takes a long time. Let's have it for another session.
Yeah, I think this is enough actually for today.
Any
at least the basic.
Yeah, I hope you can grasp the basic, like how to load the data, the data types, vector and raster. I will send you the correct link.
Okay, no problem. I didn't
check the link to open it. Then basic thing like projection and coordinate system, we have to understand. Otherwise, like when I made a mistake, like when I put latitude in longitude, then the data is somewhere else, not in the region.
Okay.
Also, what else? I think that's the basic part. The most important part is projection and coordinate system, then raster and vector, then other things. It's like how to do accessibility analysis. It depends on the task. Like if we want to do accessibility analysis, then there are many ways to calculate the distance between the source point to the farthest access, for example, by using Euclidean distance or using that surface area analysis or using the simple one is buffer. Just make a buffer 500 meters, then you can assume that's the area accessible from well, for example, from a well or from market, from hospital and other things. In my opinion, the best one is using surface area analysis, because people use roads to move between one place to another place. So people not like birds who can fly directly using Euclidean distance. Unless it's a desert, it's okay. All parts of the desert.
So you provided me like few links. So how to get what kind of data actually I can obtain from there? like USGS, there is one, okay. Right?
Yeah, that one actually, it is, I think, I thought I could explain it to you also, but basically, that's for remote sensing analysis. So we will use this plugin. It's called semi-automatic classification plugin. This one, semi-automatic classification plugin to analyze the land cover, and those link will be needed to download the data.
Okay.
So we put the credentials in here for EROS, this one, for Earth Data in this one, and for Sci-Hub this one. So better to put all the credentials in one time, then we can search the data here. For example, if we use Landsat 15 MSS, we can search the data until 1978, for example. So if we want to do multi-temporal analysis, for example, then let's see, oh, sorry. You can search data here, for example. Where is that? You can search from the archive. There is no data, something, maybe there is no archive. This is one is I will use the recent one. For example, so we will need that those credentials to search the data and then download. So,
okay. So you got, I mean, in the in your laptop, it's like in QGIS.
Yes.
So, because in my window, it's not showing this all this SPC, UMEP. So should I go to plugins and then install or download this semi-automatic classification yes. plugin?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
So this is, that's the most important thing that I forgot. The good thing with QGIS is there are many plugins. In this plugins, manage and install plugins, then the next step is in settings. Usually I tick this one. I choose to show also experimental plugins. Although it's experimental, sometimes it works. Then reload the repository to show also the experimental plugin. So there are around 650, but if I don't check, for example, it's around 500. So 130 something plugins that may be useful for our study that we can use. So better to use experimental, but not choose the deprecated plugins. So
okay, then show experiment and then
Reload.
Done.
Done, yes. Then, not yet. So it means it will load the available plugins, but we have okay. to search this, for example, classification. Then related to classification, there will be, if we put the word class, then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 plugins that can be chosen. Then we click this one and then install.
Okay.
So this is for classification. And if we want to show like the background, usually I use this one, Quick Map Services. Quick Map Services. We can load Google Earth, not Google Earth, Google Maps. So it will be easier for us to find the area. This is, for example, as a background. So we can search our study area. And it's also useful for example, if we want to present something before we download the data, then we discuss with our colleague the area that we are going to choose for the research, maybe.
Okay.
So you can play around in this plugin, for example, water. Then there are water network tools. I'm not familiar, but I have installed this Indian watershed. I don't know what is this. Basically.
Yeah, I just saw that one.
And then evapotranspiration. This is for water balance, I think.
Oh, it's Q water model. Okay. Okay, so whatever we you will install, then it will actually come to the map if we work, right?
The plugin will be shown in this toolbox, right?
Okay.
And, I have this Zsaka classification plugin, and when I click, then it will goes to. It will make new doc, something like this.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's great.
So I think if you have the data, for example, just sample of your research, then what you can try to input the data to QGIS, and then we can have another discussion. But for raster file, I think maybe next time how to do classification and classification with Landsat.
Yeah.
Whether you have the data or not, I think we can do the discussion. But for specific analysis, maybe you can explain to me what is your work, and then what is the data, and then what we can do with this data for GIS okay. analysis.
Yeah. Great.
So I hope that helps.
Yeah, of course. I hope it's very important to understand the basics. Yeah, no problem. I will start working and checking, because this is very basic for me.
Okay.
And then if I feel something issue, then we can talk next time. No problem.
Okay. Or yeah. Or send me a message through WhatsApp.
Yeah.
I can help, and I will respond.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Great.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah, this is very, very useful.
You're welcome. I still remember when I think I stayed in your dorm, right? And having the curry.
Yeah.
I still remember the taste.
Which one? I forgot actually.
Curry, the curry, yeah. chicken curry with the potato.
Yeah.
When I stayed in AIT, I think the taste is different.
Yeah.
Maybe in AIT they provide this Indian style.
Yeah.
Different, yeah.
Indian style, yeah, that was Indian.
So yeah, I miss this time.
No problem, yeah. So when you come here or I visit Indonesia, then I can cook for you.
But there is no this specific ingredients for curry. I think it's difficult to find here.
Yeah, we do have in Bangladesh, but I don't think Indonesia is actually bringing any masala from Bangladesh. Masala they always buy from India, I think. Yeah. Mm,
Indian masala, I think, yes.
Mm. But I use like Bangladeshi one. Typical.
Okay. Let's see if we can. Of course, we will have another discussion because it's only the basic. I hope it triggers you to have more questions in your mind.
Yeah,
it can be done by GIS related with your research.
Yeah, lots of things actually. I've been doing lots. For example, last few years I worked in Mongolia and Bangladesh on the waste pickers. The waste pickers who is collecting waste from different locations like plastics and papers and all those things and bottles. So I collected data from different part of the city, and maybe somehow there is a possibility to incorporate those information in the GIS mapping. I'm not sure. I mean, two cities like Ulaanbaatar and also Dhaka, for example.
So what was the main problem of these waste pickers? Is there any?
Yeah, so we explored like health and livelihood status of waste pickers in those cities. So what kind of climatic factors influencing, or socio-cultural factors like the economic or rainfall or any other environmental related issues actually impacting on their livelihood. And of course, because these people they don't protect themselves and they don't use any gloves or any kind of protective equipments, so they're really exposed to various kind of diseases. We found a lot of information actually how people are affected by different kind of disease, like infectious disease, back pains, and there's so many other health hazards we found. So somehow maybe we could use this kind of information. And this is only one, but I've done lots of multidisciplinary research in water, sanitary, and also disaster.
Yeah, I read your CV. So many publications.
Yeah, so, but very few research I applied actually detailed GIS mapping, but just only for maps like capital, just map, simple map.
Okay.
But I'm actually interested to incorporate some basic landscape, and also because I'm also teaching ecology here.
Oh,
geology, ecology. Because sometimes when you see all this list of my publications, it's also difficult to correlate with my teaching. So some of the water management I'm teaching,
Global water sanitation hygiene, urban water sanitation hygiene, I'm teaching. These are actually related to my research. And then those which are not research-based is actually ecology with lab. So I also have lab, different kind of like methods, ecological methods, and marine ecology, terrestrial ecology, all those ecology. I'm still learning lots, and from students as well. And also this semester I also taught geology.
Okay.
So I thought maybe because I'm teaching all these things, GIS is very much important actually to incorporate in teaching as well, right?
Yes. Like this terrestrial ecology, you can apply GIS, remote sensing, and GIS for this terrestrial ecology.
Exactly. Or the land use pattern, like land use change and land use cover, all these things. Watershed degradation, right? This kind of thing.
Yeah
there are so many students coming from different part of the Asia or Middle East, and I strongly believe I can get lots of different data from those students, and then we both can actually work on that for publication. What do you think?
That will be great because I believe I can learn a lot from you how to write. Now I work at university, then I have to publish.
Before, this is important. Yeah,
I didn't have any obligation, so just maybe project report is okay. But now I have to make scientific journal.
I can help how to write those things, but I maybe somehow I can help from my expertise, and then you can contribute from your point of view, and then both we can work together with the students. Actually, student can they're amazing actually, those students. They're highly talented students, and they're supporting me lots. And one of my students actually went to Harvard last year for internship, you know. So I never visited there, I never had chance to go there, but my students are going and working in a different government agency and different universities, right? So this is really, really great, teaching students.
Yes.
I never thought I would teach students. So it was not my first choice actually, when I was a school boy or bachelor student or even master's graduate. So even when I was in Japan, I'm going to teach? No, I still remember. I never shared with you or even our friends that I'm going to actually get a faculty position or a teaching student. It was not my first choice. So, but now I think this is quite interesting. And then this is the only place to improve the network.
Yes.
Hundreds of students. Knowledge, exactly, yeah. Exactly.
From the student, it's like. When the students have question and we don't know, then we have to find the answer, right?
Exactly. We have to study lots. Yeah, that's quite great. Yeah, all like both ecology and geology. That's I'm just geology only this year. Oh. Only this year. So I never taught this course. Ecology last 2 years. I've been teaching with lab. And in geology, I provided like a virtual lab with like minerals and rocks and earthquake or landslide or all this phenomenal thing. I'm really surprised to see and teach all those things. Quite interesting.
I thought you are only the water and slum guy. But now you teach all these things.
Yeah, environmental science as well, you see. I'm also teaching this environmental science, how to say. And environmental health also. See, environmental health is also another aspect of like applying this GIS. I'm really desperate to, like air pollution. I've seen before COVID-19 and after COVID-19, what is the situation of environmental pollution, like air pollution, right? Mm. So those things is quite interesting. I found this very important, even right, to incorporate like different infectious disease in different part of the world can be also mapped, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so this kind of anything GIS is really like for every place.
Yeah, 80% of data related with.
Exactly. Yeah, and also I taught in Canada as well for last 4 years.
One thing, when you were in Canada, I have a friend. Maybe you met him, Delaware Hussein. Have you heard?
Delaware Hussein.
Just
from Indonesia?
No, from Bangladesh.
Which part of Canada?
Maybe in not in your city, because it seems that like you don't know him. Just in case. He's from AIT. For his master. When he went to Canada, I don't know which university, but he went to Canada for PhD.
Okay. No, I was there only 4 years, and then I started as a postdoc, and then after 6 months, they offered me a lecturer position part-time. Then I started teaching this global water sanitation there. Nobody taught water sanitation in those universities in Canada. So I was the only one started first time.
Okay.
And students are very happy to see that one. And then water management, and I was like lab instructor, hydrology. So anyway, so that's why actually I know a little bit about GIS, but still, because lack of practice, I forgot most of the things. Anyway.
Okay.
Yeah, great. Thank you so much. And it's
you're
great
welcome.
Time. It's my like pleasure. 11 o'clock.
Okay. See you next time.
See ya.
Let's discuss another thing. Hope it will be useful for us. Stay safe from this COVID.
Thank you. You too. I never went outside actually last 40 days.
Oh.
Almost 40 days.
40 days.
Almost 40 days. 2 months.
2 months.
2 months I visited only once for 1 hour in a bank. That's all.
Okay.
Otherwise every time at home. Oh my God. So boring.
So boring.
And scary.
Okay. Yeah, see you.
Cool. Thank you so
next
much.
Time.
Yeah.
Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.